Hey everyone, today we're going to look at installing Pi-hole on a Synology NAS, and we're going to install it as a Docker container. So we're actually going to run through two different methods on how you could do this. The first method is a little easier, and it's because we're going to be using the host network interface. Now with the second method, you're going to have to actually create a Mac VLAN network interface, and then we'll also create a bridge. So it's a few additional steps, but the benefit from that one is that your Pi-hole DNS server will have its own IP address. If you actually use the first method and you use the host network interface, you'll be using the host's IP address, which is your Synology NAS's IP. So really quickly, a few things before we get started. I have written instructions for everything in the description as always. And it's very important to note that if you set this up, your DNS server will be tied to your Synology NAS. So if you restart your Synology NAS, you'll lose the ability to resolve domain names. So it's really important to have a redundant Pi-hole server. And the best way that I could recommend is by buying a really cheap Raspberry Pi Zero on Amazon. They're like 25 bucks, but you can configure it to be a Pi-hole server as well. So when you go and you set up the DNS configurations later on, you'll have two Pi-hole servers. So if either one of them goes down, you will still be able to resolve domain names. If you are interested in that, I'll leave written instructions in the description on how you could set up Pi-hole on a Raspberry Pi. And I'm also going to leave a pop-up up top now that will show you some of the benefits of having two Pi-hole servers. So both of these processes involve a few preliminary steps. And the first thing that we need to do is we need to install Docker from Synology's Package Center. After we do that, you'll see that it actually creates a Docker folder. And inside of that folder, we need to create a Pi-hole folder. And inside of that Pi-hole folder, we need to create a second Pi-hole folder and a folder named dnsmask.d. And we're going to be mapping these folders in later steps. So after Docker's been installed, we're going to navigate to the registry and we're going to search for Pi-hole. At that point, you can double-click on the Pi-hole official image and download it. When you download it, it's going to come up and ask you what version, and you could just download the latest version. Once it's finished downloading, you can double-click the Pi-hole image, and it will launch the Docker configuration at that time. So you got to give your container a name, and then you're going to select Advanced Settings. The one thing I want to point out is that if you're going to be using Pi-hole for DHCP, you need to make sure you check off the Execute Container Using High Privilege. If you're not and you're strictly using this for DNS, you don't have to do that. So in the advanced settings, we're going to change a few things around. First, we're going to enable auto restart. And then in the volume section, we're going to go and we have to map local folders to those folders we created earlier. So when I say local folders, I mean they are the Docker containers folders. So we're going to add the DNS mask folder and the Pi-hole folder, and we're going to mount them to those container paths. Once that's done, you're going to navigate to the network section, and you're going to select the box that says use the same network as Docker host. When that's done, you can navigate to the environment section, and we're going to have to change a few variables around here. So the first thing that we're going to add is we're going to add web password. And what you put here, that's just going to be the password that you use to access the web management portal. The second thing that we need to add is a web port. So the port is what you'll actually be using to access that web portal as well. And we have to set this up because we're using our host network interface. So put something in the 8000s, that should be fine. It doesn't matter, it just needs to be something that's not currently being used. The last thing that we're gonna add is dnsmask_listening, and we're setting this to local. Finally, we have to find the server IP. Now this will already exist, and it will be listed as 0.0.0.0, but we have to go in and we have to change this to the IP address of our NAS. So when that's done, you can click apply, and now your Docker container will be complete, and you should be able to access your web address. The one thing that I want to point out is that if you're using the Synology firewall, you have to create two firewall rules in order for you to actually access that interface. The first is for the web port that we defined. So in my case, I used 8888, so I'll have to create a firewall rule that allows traffic into that port. And for that, you can use just TCP. And the second thing that we need to do is we need to open the port 53. Now this is for the DNS resolving. You have to open this port and you have to open it for all network protocols. Once those steps are done, you should be able to access the web page. And at that point, you'll have to log in with that web password that we created earlier. Now, we haven't actually configured the DNS portion for your clients to use this DNS server, so if you're not interested in learning about the second option, you can skip to the end of the video. I'll leave a timestamp in the description. So the second option that you could do is you can actually set up Pi-hole with a Mac VLAN network interface. And like I said earlier, this allows your Pi-hole instance to actually have its own IP address, so you won't be utilizing the host NAS's IP address. It's also super important to note that for some reason, the latest version does not work with this method. And in specific, I am talking about version 5.1.1. So I have written instructions in the description, and I'm going to go based on creating this off of the version 5.1, but check out the written instructions when you're watching this, because when there's a new update that actually works, the latest version works, I'm gonna update them to let you know that you can safely use that newest version. So in order to create this new Mac VLAN network interface, we have to actually SSH into our Synology NAS. Go to the terminal and SNMP section, and then make sure that you enable the SSH service. If you're running the Synology firewall, you'll also have to ensure that port 22 has traffic allowed. So once you SSH into your Synology NAS, the first thing we're gonna do is actually create a resolve.conf file. And this is because this Docker container, for whatever reason, has a bunch of DNS resolving issues if you don't specifically specify what DNS servers to use. So this file is pretty much telling our Docker container to use these two DNS servers. When that's done, we need to find the network interface that our Synology NAS is using. So to do that, you have to type in ifconfig, and when you see that, you'll see every single network interface that is connected to your Synology NAS. And wherever you find your IP, the Synology NAS's IP, that network interface is what we're going to use in the next step. So now we're going to create our Mac VLAN network interface. And the important thing to note in this is that whatever IP address you want to use, that's what you'll have to specify where I am putting 198. So the IP address I'm using for my Docker container is 192.168.1.198. If you want this to be something else, you'll have to change that there. Also, if you're using a different subnet, you'll have to change this command to be based on the subnet that you're using. So our network's now created, and we have to go back to our Synology DSM, and we have to actually open up Docker, and we have to create a bridge network. Now this bridge network is what allows our host to actually communicate with our container. So it can't communicate directly with our container, but it can communicate with it through this bridge interface. So when you're creating this bridge interface, you just have to use a subnet that's not currently in use. I'm gonna be using 192.168.10, but you could use whatever you want, just make sure that it's not in use. Now, once that bridge network's created, we'll have both of the networks that we'll be using fully created. So we have to open up Docker, we have to navigate to the registry, and we have to search for Pi-hole. And this is where I was mentioning earlier that the newest version has some sort of a bug. So I'm gonna download the version 5.1 because I know it works. At that point, you can double-click the image to create it, give it a name, and then open the advanced settings. So we're gonna check off enable auto restart. Then we're gonna go to the volume section and we're gonna map our DNS mask and Pi-hole folders to the container's internal folders. And we're gonna also add a file, and that file is gonna be the resolve.conf file that we created earlier. And we're gonna set the mount path as etc/resolve.conf. And we're doing that so that we're specifying to our Docker container, use these DNS servers when you load. We then have to go over to the network section and we have to add the two Pi-hole network interfaces that we created. So that's the Pi-hole network and the Pi-hole bridge. At that point, you'll have to give it a web password, DNS mask listening set as local, virtual host can be set as Pi-hole, and the server IP is the IP address of the Mac VLAN network that we created earlier. So you can now select apply. This will create your Docker container. And after it finishes loading, give it a few minutes. You should be able to access it by navigating to the IP address of the Mac VLAN network we created /admin. At that point, you should get to the web portal and you'll be able to log in with the password you specified earlier. At this point, Pi-hole is fully configured and you'll actually be able to utilize it and set it up as you'd like. There are a ton of different things that you could change around in here, so I really suggest you kind of look around and see what you could find, see what you'd like to block. You're definitely going to have to whitelist some things, but you kind of have to configure Pi-hole at this point. So the last thing that we need to do is we need to set up the DNS configuration on our client devices. So what I normally do is I point my router to this DNS server, and I do that so that every single device that is connected to my router is using my PI/hole server as its DNS server. However, you do not have to do that. If you want to actually specify this on a per device level, you can. You just have to do it for every single client device. So in the written instructions, I have different links that will show you how to do it on Windows, Mac, or Linux. But until you do that, these PI/hole DNS servers will not be used. So this is kind of the final step. I'm not going to show it because every router is different, but it's important to note that until you actually set that, you won't be utilizing this PI/hole DNS server. So that wraps up the tutorial for today. Once again, I want to note that it's very, very important to create a redundant PI/hole server. So I'll leave those instructions in the description. If you guys have any questions, please leave them in the comments. If you like the video, give it a thumbs up and please subscribe. Thanks.